All right. Very great. Welcome to the video. We're going to see what we can do to calm the waters of the world, if that's possible. The mosquitoes are already out and moving around. It's a heat wave in California, April 29th, 2014. Let us several things as we start. Let us remember we always start in the mood of repentance, which is, say, admit that I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't even have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. I don't have any other problem, just the continuity problem. That's it. So the time problem has no value to me whatsoever. Only the continuity problem has value. Only the vision of oneness has value because it solves the continuity problem. So only the vision of oneness has value, for it solves the continuity problem. Mosquitoes are flying around. I've got the citronella candle there. Hopefully it'll help. And then, so in the mood of repentance is sober, very sober. We realize we're attempting a great task here. So ask yourself, when you're going to do something that is extremely important to you, are you not going to be very, very sober? At your best, at your best. It's like that serious, focused, sober, non-reactive, non-disputive, non-emotionalized, and just saying, okay, today is the day that I'm going to make a big breakthrough. This is the moment. I'm going to make a huge breakthrough. It's that attitude, as the mood repents. I'm going to make a huge breakthrough. Right now, it's going to happen. Have to have that, or else the breakthroughs won't come. When you have this mood, the breakthroughs do arrive, for sure. Now, we say that I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, for I am as God created me. Truly, we are not bodies, we are spirit. We are spirit. Then we say, I relax my mind. I relax my mind. I let go of my I let my thoughts go. I release my thoughts and let them go. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts, and I let them go. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts. And I let them go. So, with that in mind, we will call to mind the goal, which is what? It is the I Am Presence, the vision of oneness, I Am Presence. The timelessness. The timeless vision of oneness, the timeless I Am Presence, the I Am-ness. The I Am-ness is right now. It doesn't need another instant to be what it is, to become what it is. It is I Am, full stop. I Am, full stop. Okay. So, a few practices to warm us up here. I applaud all applause to the intrinsic, bright, peaceful, great perfection of I Am. I cheer the traceless, clean, blissful authenticity of I Am. I laud the identical, fresh oneness of the all goodness of the one identity. I approve of the baseless, exquisite, forgiving empowerment of I Am. I praise the infallible, ineffable, glorious simplicity of I Am. I commend the mindless, majestic, serene relaxation relaxation of I am. I recommend the uncontrived, ethereal, calm being of I am. I acclaim the natural, perfect, inclusive, pure matrix of I am. I hail the spaced out, splendid identity of the core of I am, of core I am. I compliment the undifferentiated, superb, grateful changelessness of I am. I magnify the all-pervasive, flawless, relieved awareness of I am. I celebrate the non-congealing, incomparable, smoothed out illumination of I am. I celebrate the non-congealing, incomparable, smoothed out illumination of I am. I extol the unborn, superlative clarity, clear recognition of I am. I honor the unceasing, precious, fresh enlightenment of I am. I salute the non-crystallizing, matchless, abiding miraculousness of I am. I exalt the wide open, wonderful, blessed sureness of I am. I adore the unelaborated, sublime, blessed treasure of I am. I cherish the immaculate, exalted, graceful ecstasy of I am. So we have the peaceful perfection of I am, the blissful authenticity, the one all goodness, the forgiving empowerment, the glorious simplicity, the serene relaxation, the calm being, the inclusive pure matrix, the grateful changelessness, the relieved awareness, the smooth illumination, the clear recognition, the fresh enlightenment, the abiding in miraculousness, the eternal life treasure, the blessed sureness, the graceful ecstasy. And these are just some terms out of many, many, many that we could use. So we have this great golden mountain of I am, the one shared identity. I am the one shared identity. So, the talk is now, and we will start out with stating the obvious, which is, make sure there's no mosquitoes here, is the world, time is a lynch mob. Okay, what is time? It's a lynch mob. It is literally a lynch mob. When you think of time, what is it that time's after? It's a lynch mob. That's how it plays out. The world is a lynch mob right now. It's a lynch mob. And there's nothing more frightening than a lynch mob. All by design. What is the purpose of existence? Create failure. To create failure. Now, this is not something that anyone who is really into the world wants to hear. It's only for those who are starting to realize, hey, wait a minute, I'm tired of this place. I've had enough. And it's time to recognize what is it that I've been struggling with for many lifetimes, for sure. And for some, they'll say in this one, in this lifetime, they've been struggling greatly. Oh yeah, definitely, definitely. I try to think I can make the world a great place if I just helped out and used all my talents and capabilities here. And it didn't turn out that way at all. In fact, I found everybody, I noticed something very odd. Growing up, I had the capacity for precognition, very, very gifted with precognition. And I could just offhand just tell people what was going to happen, just like this, like nothing. I just knew what was going to happen before it happened. And people got very angry with me. And I recently realized, it's because the purpose of the world is to fail. And when you know a failure's coming, something bad's coming, then you're going to, if you allow it to impact you, people are going to say, hey, what an idiot, you know, why did you allow that? But if you claim ignorance of it, you say, I didn't know, you know, how could I know these things? It was just bad luck, or, you know, or whatever. Yeah, just terrible accident, terrible fate, But the purpose of the world is to fail, is to create failure, is to actually cause reality to fail. As Jesus says, existence is an attack upon God. It's an attempted attack upon God, which is completely futile. God cannot be attacked. But certainly the purpose is to figure out how to change reality, how to get reality to fail, to be what it is. That is the purpose. So when I tell people, look, there's a problem coming in your life, and I don't want to hear about it. And then when it would come, you know, they wouldn't say anything, you know, like, if I told them, they would never admit to it. They don't want to know. They don't want to know. People don't want to know what's going to happen because they want to blame the world. Say, look what the world did to me. You know. Whereas if they know it's coming and they still allow it to happen, then you have to say, well, why did you allow that to happen? And then the cat's out of the bag. You know, cat's out of the bag because we're working on all these prototypes. It's a laboratory experiment. We're like guinea pigging our bodies, or guinea pigs, or laboratory rats. And we're working on trying to find a way that actually can cause reality to fail. And I found out it was impossible. So that's the difference between me and someone else in the world. Not that I'm smarter than someone else, but I've been to this world so many times, so many hard knocks. And then finally, this lifetime, I tried to be the perfect failure, and I found out it's impossible. Spirit cannot change itself. You cannot commit spiritual suicide. It's impossible. All you get to is mental chaos, total mental chaos, but you're still aware, perfectly aware of that. Your awareness cannot be touched. Pure awareness, which is above consciousness. Consciousness can become very confused, but there's still this pure awareness of the confused consciousness. In other words, when I had my consciousness was in complete chaos, total, endless chaos. I said, it had lost all references, and it was just, and my awareness was perfectly clearly aware of this and just looked at it and says, you know, consciousness, that's not something that can be tolerated at all. I don't want this. I reject this. This is not the answer. And because the goal was to cause awareness to die, and awareness can't die. So then I said, oh, wow, I got a big continuity problem here, because, you know, all I know is failure, really. All the world teaches us is failure. And we think it's success. We think it's success because we believe that once we succeed at failure, we'll be the ultimate success. So we'll say, well, sure, there's some bumps along the way. There's some tough, you know, it's a tough road. But think about the benefit at the end of the road, right? Ultimate success, greater than God. I'll be the new prime creator. So we're willing to put up with a lot of tomfoolery along the way, for sure. Death after death after death. We're willing to put up with a lot of death. Now, my last death, I said, hey, this is the last one. I don't want to have another one. And I found myself being conned back into this world because the world was screaming. They needed help. They're so stuck and all this. You know, I said, okay, I'll come back and try to help. And it turns out it was all a scam, of course. And I realize, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die again. I don't wanna die again. I got tricked again. So we're willing to put up with that. But I said, no, that's enough. That's enough. No more. No mas. Because I know there's no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow of failure. We cannot fail to be what we are. It's impossible. So all of this death and dying that people put up with for so long, it was all just a bag of rocks, worthless waste of time. And when you see that, you say, hey, you know, I want to dispense, I want to set down this failure project, actually. And that's when the continuity problem, that's when you become aware of it. See, before you're not aware of the continuity problem, because you say, I'll eventually succeed at what I'm doing here in the world. I'll be a success eventually. When you realize you can't succeed at failure, then you say, what do I do? You know, well, I got to set it down. I can't set it down. You know, that's all I know. That's all I know. This is my identity. You know, there's no way I can set it down. So that's when you realize the continuity problem. And then you're like, uh-oh. I said, whoa, what's that? You know, this dread arises in you. I said, whoa, what's that? I said, Houston, we have a big problem. Yeah, it is. We have a gigantically severe continuity problem, actually. And again, it's only when you turn around and say, okay, I'm going to have to set failure down because I've had enough. That's when it strikes you. You get the nightmares, you get the fears, you get, you know, when you're trying to set it down, your life is hell for a while. You get all these terrible nightmares and you have problems sleeping and you're fearful and nervous and you're just like, wow, you know, I can't figure out how to set this down. Well, where's this fear coming from? You know, it's amorphous. It's a very amorphous fear. Free-floating anxiety, and no shrink can figure out what the heck's going on. Seriously. For me, they just said, look, we can't help you. Every therapist said, we can't help you. There's nothing we can do for you anymore, sorry. Because they didn't know where it was coming from. It's coming from because I realize I have no choice but to set failure down. No choice. And so, how do I do this? You know, I was like, oh my God, I'm going to lose my mind. I'll lose my identity. And it's just like, freaking out like that. Now, fortunately and miraculously, with the grace of God, I came across help. Without that, then there's no way I could have succeeded. Certainly not this lifetime, and maybe many, 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 many more. So, I did get the help, and worked like a workaholic, which I already was a workaholic in previous lives. And this life, I would definitely spare no effort. And even so, it's been extremely difficult. The continuity problem is very nasty, very severe. It's still there, you know, it's still there to a certain extent. To what extent, I don't know. Maybe not so much, I don't know. I'm not going to try and measure it because, you know, it's better to keep trying, keep chipping away at it, keep evaporating it. So what we do here is we work on evaporating the continuity fear. Otherwise, you're not going to set failure down. The failure project, you're going to hold on to that failure project, and guess what? You're going to experience failure. Quote unquote, symbolic failure. You know, time-based failure. And of course, time doesn't really, it's not real, actually. It's not real at all. It's just a convenient mirage, an illusion that we believe in to make it seem like it's possible, that failure could be possible. Without time, failure is impossible. The whole concept, the idea of failure is impossible in timelessness. So when we have these peak moments of timelessness, something sort of dawns and says, well, okay, this is great, but what about the failure? What about my project? I can't do anything about it. I've got to get back into time. You know. So that's the problem, is we're so used to failure, thinking that failure is success. That we, when in timelessness, we say, okay, this is great, but what about my success? You know, where's my success here? possible. Ask yourself, ask yourself, does success need to succeed? I mean, does truth need to succeed? Does reality need to succeed? Does everywhereness need to succeed? Does pure spaciousness need to succeed? Succeed at what? What's it need to succeed at? It's created perfect. It's enjoying its creation, but does it need to succeed at being what it is as far as measurable success or something? Truth, what does truth need to succeed at? It's already true. So it doesn't need to succeed at defeating a lie or, you know, trying to change itself in any way. There's nothing about reality that needs to change itself at all, none. So there is no need for time in reality. Time is the measure of change, actually, to have any meaning, actually. Change in what is. Change in what is. But what is never changes. So there isn't really any time. It's just we believe in time. And it's the greatest belief we have. It's the cornerstone of our delusion, actually. Now, when someone says there is no time, I know that's a stumbling block for everybody. Some more, some less. Certainly has been a stumbling block for me. I say, what are you talking about? I don't get it. And it can take a long, hard, a difficult effort to, you know, not stumble so bad. What you got to do is you stumble on it and just keep going as best you can. Keep going, that's all. Hit your toe on it, just, okay. Whatever. I'm just going to just assume that this is so, because it's been said that it is so, so many have said it's so, and intuitively I know it's so, but I just can't quite grasp why, but that's okay. It's a gradual kind of thing. It's fuzzy, you know, it's fuzzy and gets a little less fuzzy. What do you mean timelessness? It's getting progressively less fuzzy for me, but still, you know, it's quite amazing. Don't let it be a stumbling block. We're not talking about chronological time, of course. We're talking about the issue of becoming, of change in anything, actual change of process. We're talking about, there is no process, there is no change, there is no becoming, there isn't any of that in terms of reality, the being, the isness, the I am-ness, the everywhereness, the truth of reality. There isn't any change in that whatsoever. We're trying to change it. So of course we believe in time. If we didn't believe in time, the idea of changing reality would instantly vanish, wouldn't it? There'd be no way to even think about experiencing it. There's something, a bug. So I know the intellect says, well, I gotta figure this timelessness thing out. What is this? It you're not gonna get it that way. It's kinda, you have to get it indirectly. It's a slow, usually dawn for us. What it's meant, there's no such thing as time. Don't struggle with it too much. Don't struggle with it too much. I just try to say little snippets here, and you just kind of just soak it in, pick up a little bit like that and that. Gradually the picture emerges, like a magnet pulling iron filings in. And gradually the shape of the magnet becomes, you know, visible. Let's say if it's an invisible magnet, you can see the iron filings show, you know, what it is. So just let the iron filings, you know, come in and attach, and the whole, and the level gradually, this timelessness will you'll get a sense of that. Enough so it's not a concern, not a worry, not a mystery. And we have to talk about it because it's the cornerstone. It's the cornerstone of delusion. Now, this world is a lynch mob. This world, this planet is a lynch mob. The time is a lynch mob. And we're living in a time of the lynch mob, actually, right now. Everybody's neck is in the noose right now. Everybody's neck is in the noose. Whether they know it or not, there's some where they're coming to tighten the noose. In fact, time is a noose upon everyone's neck. It really is a noose upon everyone's neck. It's a death sentence. But again, what's the purpose? Failure. So there is this desire to see some fail rather rapidly and extremely coming up here. So the nooses are about to tighten around their necks. Lynch mob, there's no trial. There's no case presented. There's no lawyering. There is no rebuttals. There is no recourse. There is just simply a complete group mob. A mob simply feels righteously that they know what the truth is and that this one must hang right now without any delay, without any due process whatsoever. That's a lynch mob. Now, lynch mob can form over anything, can't they? Say, I didn't like the way someone looked at me. And when the people are in the mood of a lynch mob, they'll say, hey, let's lynch them. And then, off they go. Grab them, take them out, and lynch them. Now, in these days, they don't lynch people quite that way, not yet. But give them time, give them a little time, for sure. They'll get there. So we have a lynch mob mentality in the world. What's driving this? Again, the purpose of existence is to cause reality to fail. So we symbolize bodies as symbolizing life. Okay, bodies symbolize life, these physical bodies. So for a body to die, that symbolizes the death of life. And then therefore we think that this is somehow symbolizes to us the ability to change reality. But it hasn't worked, and of course it never will work. So we think that we need a lot of bodies to die, and that we make up this idea of a cumulative effect, a build-up effect, that the effect doesn't take place now. It needs a lot of time to gather momentum, build up, until it finally has its effect. It's slow acting. We say slow acting, very slow acting. So we're waiting for this very slow acting magic of death to work its magic on reality. And we keep upping the dosage, we want to keep it's like an IV. Basically we feel we've got reality on an IV. And it's an IV of death. And all these bodies are just drops of in IV fluid going into the body of reality, as it were. And we feel if we just keep putting in more bag, and then like putting more and more medicine, higher doses in the IV, that each drop of death will eventually wear away reality until it actually changes. And we are able to change the very nature of reality, is what we're trying to do, so that our creations won't recognize their creator. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to create differently than creation creates. So we can claim that we're the ones who are creating reality, and that reality is just a mirage. We're trying to say that the mirage is real and reality is a mirage. That's what we're trying to do. That's what we're used to doing. That's the whole purpose of all this idiocy, this whimsical idiocy we're engaged in. And the body and death and time are at the heart of it. Appearances in time and space. Time and space, appearances, the death, the disappearance of everything. IV. So we got this IV hooked up. And we're just feeding it. Now, there are times when the doctor comes in and says, we need to, put this particular dosage in the IV because this is it. Now's the time to do this. It's like an art and a science kind of blended together. Like how are we going to be able to get, God to die, reality to die? And we have these knowledgeable doctors. We call the head of the doctor team, we call the ego. And the ego says, okay, look, we got to mix and match the different medications, the different types of death, different types of trauma. It's not just death, it's trauma, it's worry, it's fear. It's all of these drugs, you know, are put into the IV. We have like a potential famine, for instance, in California, which will certainly affect the world if it happens, because California is, what, the fifth largest gross domestic product in the world. You know, it's just gigantic as far as its economy is concerned. And if this drought goes through one more year, it's going to have a collapse of the economy. It's going to be just disastrous here. And so, of course, we're all like, whoa, you know, here's something I feel like. And worry, like what? The good times are dying. The state, it may die. You know, the fertility of the state may die. You know, the good standard of living, you know, may die. All that. So there's a lot of different kinds of dying. Whatever we value in this world is all a setup so that we lose it. And in the losing of it, feel that it has failed us. You see, it's a failure. We're here to experience failure, actually. We're here to, as failure junkies, failure addicts, actually. And if you look at your life and look at history and look at everything objectively, you can see it. You can actually see it. I did it with my life and I said, wow, definitely incredible. I set myself up for so much failure. Now, it's the carrot and the stick. There's the good and the bad, so to speak. The good just is a setup for the bad. So what I found is I get put in these situations and think, oh, okay, so much opportunity for success. And then the failure comes. You see, it's a setup. We set ourselves up. So the world is this attempt to cause reality to fail to be what it is. And the reality is one extension, going one direction, but everything is aware of everything. Everything knows everything, all simultaneously. So it's impossible for anything to not know everything. Its creator, you know, the prime creator, spirit, everything created. It's one knowledge. We're trying to create where our creations, the creations, have no knowledge of the creator at all. In fact, have no knowledge of anything. They're just reacting, just reacting. So obviously there's a big continuity problem when we've been doing this for so long and then we decide to set it down. Because we just, you know, we're just like, is it just a huge turnaround for us, a huge turnaround. So these lynch mobs are really the doctor saying, look, I think this is what we need to put in the IV now. We've got reality. It seems like reality is starting to succumb, maybe, and let's put this dosage, let's dose them this way. Now, in this world, truth has been pointed out many times. People have decided, hey, you know, let's turn away from this. This isn't working. We don't want it. There is salvation for us. Let's get after it. Let's arrange society in such a manner as to help us, everyone, get after this. Okay, that's a sane society. There are times when the world turns away from sanity like that and goes back into the most virulent kind of insanity, where it says, hey, you know what? What were we thinking all these thousands of years of trying to reach salvation? You know, that's not success. They say success is we got to succeed at failure. Once we do that, will be the ultimate success. So they say, let's all get back on the failure train and ride it to the end, and then we'll all be happy forever after. So you have these times where the world turns back towards failure in a big, big, big way. And apparently this is the worst time ever at this time. It's the prophecy and scriptures say this will be the worst time ever. And the world has turned, as a globe, globally, has turned towards worshiping failure again. And so those who worship failure the most are seen as the most valuable to the ego. So what we have in this world is upside down and backwards. Those people who are most ignorant of truth and most unwilling to set the failure project down, those who are most eager and eager to try to succeed at failure, they are now in the ascendancy on this planet. They're the ones who are calling the shots on the planet. They're the ones who are deciding what values the future will have for everybody. They're the ones in charge. They're the ones everybody's afraid of, actually. They're the ones that nobody can criticize. They're the ones that seem to have Teflon, they can do no wrong, because they're doing the ego's bidding. They are saying, hey, we gotta succeed at failure. That's the only option we have. That's what they're saying. It's the only option, folks. And anyone who says that there's another option is crazy and needs to be lynched. That's their attitude right now. And it's not long before, you know, action follows attitude, doesn't it? So the attitude is there totally. It is there severely. So how long does it take before action follows attitude? Not very long. So the world is most certainly not only at a crossroads, it's gone past the crossroads. It's in fail mode. The world is in fail mode. What do we do about it? What can be done about it? Can we push back? Can we push back? Possible. Possible. Is there an alternative to paying attention to the world? Paying attention to the news, especially. Paying attention to what's going on in the world, paying attention to the attitude, the failure attitude of the world. Is there an alternative? And keep in mind that the world believes that it's heading pell-mell to success, that it's on the fast track to success. It's almost there. It feels like it's, oh, this is so, remember, the belief of the ego is that to create failure is to succeed, is success. So the world, as it thinks it's going, thinks it's real close to causing failure of reality, causing reality to fail, it thinks it's very close to success. So the world is actually feeling like, wow, we're like on the fast track to success here. We're almost there. And so most of the world is having this forced celebration about how enlightened and progressive everybody is, because they say, well, we're closing in on success here. Now, what they're closing in on is intense efforts towards failure, and of course they don't work, but they define them, because they're intense efforts towards failure, they define them as, it must be closing in on success, has to be. That's a definitional game they play. So you can't really get through to them, because it's so much defined. They've defined the whole structure in a certain way. They say, because this is a very intense phase of failure, that has to mean, therefore, we must be extremely close to success. And then what you have to say is, well, if success is impossible, which I know that it is, then you're not closing in on success, and it's just a waste of time. A tremendous waste of time is what you're closing in on. Okay, and needless suffering, right? And needless symbolic failures of all types. So there is this lack of communication in the world because of these definitional structures that people have, these based on the premise. If you believe that it's possible to succeed, then from there you can construct an entire belief system that then will automatically define for you what you're doing. And as you see in failure intensifying, you will automatically assume you must be getting close. You must be getting close. You must be closing in on success. So to stop it at that level, you see, is definitional level, is not really effective. So how can we push back? How can we push back here and push back the obsession with failure? Well, what we can do is we can introduce, you know, what is true success. so people can see the difference. They say, well, wait a minute, okay, this is true success. And they start thinking, hey, no, trap. Bring some awareness to the world by examples of real success, which means setting the failure project down, setting it down, having the continuity problem be resolved. This would be one way. Is that possible? It's possible. Sure, it's possible. I'd certainly like to participate in some situation like that. I'm trying to do a little bit here. It's very, very minimal. Very minimal. But we better do it before the lynch mob arrives at our door. It's already at our door, banging on the door, as a matter of fact. Those who want to succeed at failure, they want to get rid of all those who don't share their enthusiasm for it, you see? Who don't feel that they're the bee's knees, you know, who don't feel like that they're sure to succeed. They say, ah, you don't have faith in us, you don't believe in us, you don't think that we're important, we don't think we're special, you don't think we can do it. Ah, well then, you know, off with your head. We can't have that negative kind of attitude around here. And that's the whole focus of this world at this time, is they don't want any quote-unquote negativity. You know, they don't want anyone saying, you know, you can't succeed at this. Oh, that's preventing us. Negativity is hard enough anyway. We don't need the negativity of that kind of negativity here. But the fact is, it's impossible to succeed at it. Totally impossible. It's an attempt to change the will of God, which is impossible. And all this manufactured evidence is nothing. Means nothing. Court of law, throw it all out. It's all inadmissible evidence entirely. We've never taken even one tiny step in the direction of success. Not ever. We'll never will. So when this lynch mob is at our door, the belief in time, which is the belief that failure is possible, is at everyone's door and demanding loyalty oath, demanding a loyalty oath. It won't be long before people are required to swear a statement of faith to probably do anything in this world. I renounce, you know, you go to church, you say, I renounce, you know, Satan, I renounce sin, I do this. There's like a statement of faith that you make, for instance, in the Roman Catholic Mass, and imagine in most traditions, you make a statement of faith. Well, pretty soon, there will be statements of faith that you have to make. They may hook you up to monitors, or scanners have ways to ask you questions and judge your reactions to it, to get answers, to find out, you know, what your profile is. They're already snooping and got data on just about everybody, on your email, on your some phone calls. Mostly the metadata of who you called, etc. But your credit cards, what you have bought, you know, they have an enormous amount of data. Scanning, you're going through the various web pages of Facebook and your emails, etc. Everything you've said, they have so much on what you have said, not everything, but so much on what you have said. Now people are tape recording on their smartphones what everybody says, just, you know, recording conversations, right? And then storing them on their computer so later on they can say, hey, so-and-so said this. You can set people up very easily, like you're in a social situation where you feel pressured and then you feel like you need to give an answer that you think somebody wants to hear, so you will say what they want to hear. I mean, we all do that. I certainly do that in the social scenes all the time. Oh, yeah, sure. I just agree with what anyone says. I just agree with it, basically. Or if I think they want me to disagree, then I'll disagree in just social interactions, not here. But just, you know, just so there's, just so you can just go navigate quickly through whatever there is. And say, oh, yeah, everyone's that way. You know, you're not getting the real responses from people anyway. So you have this society now that is everyone's spying on everyone. Everyone's collecting data, you know, and it's just this, why? Well, profiling will be used for jobs, for all sorts of stuff that enable you to function in society. And then it'll be used to target those who are targeted for elimination, actually. Their profiles have a negative entropic profile rate score to them in terms of not boosting up the effort to succeed at failure, you see. So I probably have a pretty low score right now, as a matter of fact. Probably at the bottom. So I'm not a happy camper in those terms at all. I feel very jittery because I know what's coming. And again, people are scared to comment anymore. You know, the fear has reached epidemic proportions, actually. They're afraid to watch videos. They're afraid to comment. They're afraid to like. They're afraid to go on record of anything because they realize they are. What they're doing is being recorded and they're being profiled, and the tribunals are coming, and the Inquisition is coming, actually. And of course it'll be a smart Inquisition, right? It'll be a smart Inquisition. Armin says, oh, it's a smart Inquisition. It's not an Inquisition, it's a smart Inquisition. We're using our smartphones, we're using apps to do it. It's really cool, you know? This is great. This is successful. This is a success, they say. This is a great success. The other one, failure. This is a great success at what? At failure. Yeah. The other one failed at failure, but this one, because we got the smartphones and the smart this and that and the apps and, you know, we're going to do this the right way this time. Do the Inquisition the right way. So you're basically, people are in one of two camps. Either they are what they say, or either they're going to go one way or the other, you know, sheep or the goats. Now, certainly, how do you push back against a situation? It would be, it seemed to me, that we would get a good sense of what success is really about. But then we would, forgiveness would enter the picture and say, hey, wait a minute. These people are just suffering from, first a severe whimsicality. And ultimately they have an incredibly huge, severe continuity problem. And so we may just need to, let them be, let them do their thing. And we're just going to sort of step off to the side here. Possible, very possible. I would say, I don't know what else will work as far as, I haven't come up with anything else other than a sort of sidestepping where we begin to realize, hey, I have a severe continuity problem, but there's a way to work on it, and then just get to work on it, and then realize what true success really is, and realize that there is no such thing as time, there is no such thing really as even of space. Time and space is a mirage, and each moment is totally free and clear of every other moment. We are entirely free. No one's done anything to anyone, as a matter of fact. There's only this play that we've engaged in, of role-playing, of failure, to try and work on this crazy scheme that we had. A lot of clarity comes into the picture. Now, what can we do again? How do we get to reassurance? How do we get to reassurance where we can just say no to the lynch mob? No. Just say no. big question, isn't it? Big question. I've been working on this question my whole life, knowing that all this is coming. It's all coming. It's here now. It's here. And a new climate of fear is gripping the planet. The global warming is not the biggest problem. It's global fear is the big problem. The climate of fear on this planet now is off the charts. Where people realize, I mean, can you believe we've been, you know, spied on. Everyone's been spied on. Constantly being spied on, being taped. Where every store we go into are being taped. And the people who are doing this, they want to succeed at failure. And so we're expected to accept their values, and we don't want to accept their values. So what do we do if we don't want to accept their values? Well, how do we get out of harm's way? These are burning questions, actually. And we need to address them to a large extent. And it's not just a few people, actually, who want these questions addressed. It's many people. It might even be a majority of people on this planet. Maybe not, but there are way more people than we realize who are simply cowering in fear and going about smiling, putting, you know, smiley face on and say, hey, I agree with everything you're saying. Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. I go along with that, too. How do I vote with this? Oh, I vote with you. You know, but inside they're saying this is all wrong. This is all upside down and backwards. This doesn't work. I want something better. I deserve something better than this. For sure. For sure. And we're engaged in this, what we call massive progressive social reengineering of society. And everyone, a lot of people, the majority seems to be saying, oh, this is great. This is exactly what we've always wanted. They go, sure, of course. Yeah, we just didn't realize it. No, meaning that we're just afraid of getting lynched if we don't go along with it. And it's all designed to bring about greater failure. All different types of very deep feelings of failure. You know, to turn away from the grace of God, to turn away from the voice of reason within, to turn away from the Holy Spirit, to turn away from truth, to turn away from setting failure down, the failure project down, and instead doubling down and saying, we can do it because we got the technology, now we can do it. You know, we used to pay attention to the wise people of this world, right? I mean, go back to like 1970, for instance. Who are we paying attention to? That was a time when we were still paying, that was pre-high technology, okay? You talk to people, they say, yeah, I mean, Srinivasagadatta, I am that. You know, I am that was very big, I am that. I believe it maybe it was a little bit later, but I believe it was in the, it came out, but it could have been in the 80s too, because there was some carryover in the 80s too. Neem Karola Baba, or I can't quite say the name. You know, Baba Ram Dass, so the big thing about going to India. Sri Anandamayi Ma was another. Ramana Maharshi was still big. I think he passed away in 1951. Krishnamurti was still talking, giving talks. Who's the other one? Oh gosh, there were many. I just can't pull his name out of the hat right now, but there were a lot. The Tibetan masters were moving around. There was interest in medieval Christian saints, a lot of interest, Saint John of the Cross, for instance, and Dark Night of the Soul. There was this great interest in human wisdom, all right, and respect for it. Great respect. Some people were listening to Sri Aurobindo, for instance. Mayor Baba. Some people were listening to Mayor Baba. And there were various and sundry swamis and gurus and sages and saints, etc. Padre Pio, you know, there was this fervent, this feeling like, you know what, humanity does know the truth, humanity does know the answer. And then what happened? what happened. What happened was, with Star Trek starting in 1966 through 1969, and then Star Wars, what was that, 1978-ish or something like that, 78, 79, suddenly all these aliens started showing up in our comic books, in our popular culture, you know, flying saucers, UFOs, Roswell, I think it was, what, 1956-ish? There was this theme building about aliens, and then everybody started hearing about all these people are being abducted by aliens. Women, all millions of women reporting having some kind of astral sex with reptilian aliens, being taken aboard these spaceships and being probed, and samples being taken, and eggs implanted or something. All these, you know, incredibly bizarre stuff began, you know, just bubbling up. The Star Wars obsession began then, and it's just gone on. And then the computer came out. I mean, the computer came out, personal computer, when did that come out? I don't know. Was it 82 or 79 or 78 or something? It's in there somewhere, right? Personal computer, home computer came out. And all these computer people seem to be very much into reptiles, dinosaurs, alien type of, you know, robotic alien cyborgs and all this, you know, bizarre stuff. Like, what the heck is this? We weren't thinking of that in the 60s and the 70s, really. So we were attuned to the great teachers of history, the Jesus Christ, Gautama Buddha, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, there are many we were attuned to and reading and interested in that. So our heroes at that time, a lot of people, were these great sages of history and some contemporary ones too. And then things started changing when the computer came out and these Star Wars type movies came out. And people started thinking, hey, you know what? I think that these aliens may be even smarter than the smartest people that have been on this planet, because they, you know, there's a sort of like tech, look at these computers, they said, you know, that's incredible, genius, you know, well, we got better geniuses here. They know how to build a computer. Well, a lot of the high technology we have actually was shared with us by aliens. This is something that, of course, might deflate some people realizing this. But there was an agreement made in this world that aliens would be able to pursue their hybridization program in exchange for sharing certain high technology secrets with the world, with certain countries, especially the United States. And that's where the technology really came from. That's where a lot of it came from. And that's why it came so fast. It came so, so fast. Plus, there's a lot of people that have come in from fourth dimensional worlds, born into this world, who already know how to program. It's second nature to them. That's what they did on their previous planets. So, you know, you see someone's born, and they're like, by the time they're 12, they can, you know, they know like four different programming languages, and by the time they're 18, they know 10 or whatever. They just like, it's just like a piece of cake for them. Whereas for me, I don't have a clue how to program anything. I'm really clueless about any of that stuff. I don't even, not even interested in the slightest bit. Zero interest in any of that as far as programming, any of that stuff. I'm still interested in what did the great sages of history have to say. So I never lost that interest in the great sages. But most of the world did. They said, wow. Oh, wow, I wonder what, you know, what's next? What's the next gadget? You know, what is the next gadget? And whoever is doing this is super cool. I'm really interested in them. So our attention has gone off the prize onto these quote tech superstars, and behind them actually are extraterrestrials. And this is you go to, like, you know, these Comic-Con conventions, etc., and you look at the people, they're all dressed like aliens, you know, really bizarre characters. Like, these are the people that they worship. These are the people they idolize. This is the idea that this is where their attention is. They think that there's some aliens who are going to be so wise that they're going to make them happy. And nobody's paying much attention to the great sages of history at all. I tried to prevent that by trying to promote the great sages of history, and I ended up being like a bottomless pit of futility. And I wasted, well, I wasted my life on that because nobody was interested. The response was so incredibly non-existent that it's just unbelievable. Because our attention was captured by Star Wars. It's gone on and on, down tablets, smartphones, and you know, I got the wide flat screens and 1,000 channels and high definition, and we'll watch high definition lynchings mobily, you know, mobily. People are getting ready, got all their smartphones so they can watch, you know, all the lynchings in high def, in real time, streaming. And they say, this is like cool. This is like a global tribunal, is what they're setting up, actually. Global tribunal, where everybody around the world, wherever they are, will be able to watch all the proceedings, you know, in high def, in real time. And they think this is like awesome, you know, it's totally awesome. Super failure. And the great teachers have been forgotten. It's absolutely nothing like it used to be. He used to mention the name of some teacher and people would say, yeah, well, tell me about him. Have you seen them? Did you read the book? You know, what books have you read? You know, did you see Krishnamurti in Ojai? Are you kidding me? You saw, wow, what was it like? You know, we're like, it's like the most important thing in the world. And I kicked myself for not being able to go see Krishnamurti in Ojai, or, you know, it's just like, I can't believe I did not. I think my grandmother did. But the timing just didn't happen. But, you know, gosh, to see someone like that, you know, is way more cool than seeing an alien, for sure. I can tell you that. The aliens are just, you know, failure meisters like everyone else. They just think they have some innovative ideas of how to succeed at failure is the only deal with the aliens. They say, yeah, we know how to fail. But we'll bring you success and failure, don't worry. And they say, everyone says, okay. I don't want to deal with that continuity problem. Let's double down on failure. That's what it is. So we've had this really a dry spell. We've got our attention off the ball. We've had a dry spell in the world. And as far as, you know, who can help? Who can really help at these times? Who can help? How are we going to be helped? And really, frankly, it's rather despairing. And it's got to be addressed. It has to be addressed. When the lynch mob's at your door, you can't just say, well, I need to spend another 10 years studying. I can't get this. You know, you got to get it. You have to get it. You have to know it. You have to have some way of saying no. Some way of saying no. That is a true no. And it's getting scary. It's getting scary. What is happening now is the time between the outrage and the execution has been narrowed down to an extraordinarily small window now. And they want it to be instantaneous. You see, what they really want is to be able to drag you out of your bed in the middle of the night and lynch you immediately. That's what they really want. To heck with, you know, any delay whatsoever. And so they're cheering on how quickly is the execution carried out. Whether it be literally or metaphorically, I mean, as far as destroying someone's life, how quickly can they destroy your life? So you're rendered a nobody. And the speed now is taking a quantum leap. This is why I was worried about in April. I said that April is going to be the month of action. Well, it's turned out to be that. And the action is to compress the time to dispense with any interval between the accusation and the execution. And of course, all insane regimes have pursued this as the ultimate, you know, ultimate goal. Is someone, anyone can make an accusation against anyone, and the sentence is carried out immediately, you know, just like they're on the spot. I mean, in Hawaii, the ancient Hawaii, they had that down pretty good. The taboo system. If, you know, you broke a taboo to a royal, someone that the taboo applies to, you know, the situation, the royals had these executioners in their entourage, actually. And if a taboo was broken, like the shadow of a commoner fell upon a royal, the commoner was immediately grass seized and their head was bashed in with this special club that they used, like that. That's it. That's how quick it was. So they had it down pretty good. So we're headed back towards that ideal, that system as an ideal. Of instant execution, and of course, global tribunal, everybody being witnesses. We are witnesses to history here. We're finding the purging the planet of these terrible reprobates. Now, of course, the third secret of Fatima talks about what happens to the church and the saints and the people of the church, the priests, the bishops, the cardinals, the clergy of the church, the parishioners, etc. And what was shown was just the streets are red and in blood coming up. Massive attack, so to speak. Whether that was shedding the blood of their reputation, shedding the blood of what was it physically, you know, is a question. We have many ways these days to shed someone's blood that doesn't necessarily involve the actual physical blood, you see. But they're getting very close to this. And the tide, you know, once the tide starts going over the dike, you know, and the storm is coming, you realize, uh-oh, the seawall is being breached. And here comes the flood. Once the first waves start going over, you say, oh, the tide must be coming in, and we're in trouble. So we are in trouble. There's no question about it. I had a very strong stress reaction today. Was shaking. I said, wow, I don't even think I should do anything or go out or anything. That this is just brutal. The brutality of the planet now is off the charts. And, you know, what's the essence of Christianity? Forgiveness, right? Forgiveness, that is the essence of it. So in other words, you forgive someone. As you forgive yourself. Golden rule. And turn the other cheek. Do not seek vengeance. Do not seek vengeance upon anyone. Forgive them for they know not what they do, etc., etc., etc. In other words, don't rush to judgment. Don't rush to punitive action. Instead, say, let's start with forgiveness here and let that sink in. Okay, that's the way you keep a world sane enough to work on the continuity problem. That's how you do it. That's not being done now. And all these people professing to be Christians, they're not doing it either, are they? Rushing to judgment these days. Incredible rushes to judgment. Instead of allowing motion to cool down, everything to cool down, everybody's rushing to judgment. That's an anti-Christian, anti-Christ attitude. First of all, everybody are just playing roles here. So let's determine what's behind all the roles, right? Our dearly beloved brethren in spirit are behind all these roles. So if we condemn them, we're condemning ourselves because we are exactly the same as them in spirit. Jesus said, judge not lest ye be judged. That's very important. So who in the world is stopping? Say, whoa, wait a minute. Let's first look within. And let's look within truth. And let's listen to the voice of truth, the voice of reason within, and ask their advice about what to do. Who's doing that? Who in power is doing that? Do we have leadership in power that is doing that? It's a very important question. Where's the mercy? Where's the forgiveness? Where's the contrition? Where's the opportunity to make contrition? You know, where is the judge? Not lest she be judged. Let he who's without sin cast the first stone. Where's that? It's forgotten because we've got our attention on all these gadgets of high-tech stuff, and we're imagining our minds, you know. So one of these days soon, we're probably going to be able to associate with these wizards, you know, these incredible tech wizards, maybe hybrids or cyborgs or aliens or something, and we're getting ready for them. We don't want to disappoint them. We want to make sure we purge the earth of anybody that is preventing them from coming here, as a matter of fact. Because these aliens say, you know, we're just not quite comfortable enough yet to come out in the open in this world. Although these tech geeks want them so desperately to do so, so they can worship them and, you know, lionize them. And they say, well, just not quite comfortable enough. You know, there's some people, their attitudes just, you know, they don't realize how great we are. They're still praying to God and Jesus and other, you know, saints and teachers, etc. And then we feel like we're disrespected, you know. So you just, if you want us to show up, you need to work on that, you know. You got to deal with that, you know, deal with it in a very intelligent, expeditious way so that we respect you, you know. And we don't want you. Some people say, okay, God, we got to just clean this world up post haste, so the, you know, the tech messiahs can show up here, so the ET messiahs can show up here. And so the shadow of doubt or the shadow of non-idolatry won't be cast upon them, right? Everyone will cast this, you know, subservience upon them. That's what they want. They don't want anyone saying, you know, I already know the truth, and you don't, you know, you certainly aren't giving me anything that I want. I already got a true hero, someone who has set down failure. So someone who set the failure project down and knows the I am presence of everywhereness, and that we're all one shared relationship. I already know them. I already have a relationship with them, that they're my heroes, you see. The ETs don't want that. They want to be the heroes. They don't want to share the limelight. That is a fact. So they want this planet cleaned up, so they can arrive here and be worshipped and receive the reverence that they want. You know, the aristocracy throughout history, what did they want? They wanted reverence. They wanted people to bow to them, right? Subservience. And the ET aristocracy to come here in this world, the hybrids, that's what they want. So they want the world cleaned up, so they fashioned this lynch mob mentality, working through global corporations, through the mass media and entertainment, and all means of communication and education in this world, to condition people to do their bidding, and to be willing and eager to purge the world of what they don't want here. And so that's what's happening. That's what's up right now. That's what's happening. It's all proceeding according to Hoyle, just exactly as they've drawn it out. So we're aware of this, most certainly aware of it. Have good humor about it. We feel that we have a trump card for all this, for sure. And it's just, when do we play the trump card? Well, I would say it's a good time to play the trump card, for sure. Now, we may say, well, we're going to leave of our own accord. We're not going to be lynched. And we're going to leave on our own accord until you, you know, calm down. you get tired of your ET overlords, you know? Hybrid overlords. You know, the whole world's turning to a fanboy and a fangirl, you know, of the hybrids to come, actually. You know, they're all modifying themselves. They say, look, we want to look like you. We're willing to change the way we look. You know, we're willing to do anything. We're willing to put, you know, all this over our body and adopt the most bizarre behavioral patterns. We're willing to be, you know, change just all our actions, our morals, our ethics, anything you want. We're willing to just change them so it fits right in with what you want us to do. And that's what they're doing. That's what the world is doing. Especially the younger people. The older people says, no. I'm going to sit down and read I Am That by Sri Nisargadatta. Or I'm going to sit down and read Pure Spaciousness translated by Keith Dowman, by Longchenpa. Or I'm going to sit down and read the Holy Bible by the Synoptic Gospels and the letters, New Testament, Old Testament. I'm going to sit down and read the Torah. I'm going to sit down and read A Course in Miracles. I'm going to sit down and read the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita. I'm going to sit down and read the Buddhist teachings, many varying teachings. I'm going to sit down and read the Quran. I'm going to sit down and read, you know, this book by this faith. I'm going to sit down and do meditation. I'm going to sit down and contemplate. I'm going to sit down and practice spiritual practices. That's what we're going to do. Or I'm going to listen to satsang. I'm going to go satsang. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to pray. I'm going to, you know, fill my life with truth from those who know the truth. I may do Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, however you say it. I'm going to read the Journey Beyond Words, for instance. Key to Scriptures, like Christian Science. I'm going to read Key to Scriptures, however you say that. And on and on and on and on and on, depending on your faith and what your style you like. You know, a lot of different styles. Different people go for different religions or different styles. I appreciate all religions, actually. I see good, very good, strong aspects of all of them. And there's some that, you know, some aspects don't seem to be quite as strong as they could be, etc. But I say, yeah, I can see something really helpful here and really helpful there and helpful here, etc. Or you can see just something all helpful in just one of them, too. But we may need something even, you know, something additional right now. I would say so. I would certainly say so. Time to take off the gloves, right? You know, they start a brawl, it's time to get out of Dodge when the brawl starts happening. And of course, they're telling us we can't get out of Dodge. And we're saying, well, I beg to differ about that. So the table is set, for sure. The table is set. Is can it be recaptured? What's going to happen? It's a huge question, and I leave everyone with this question because it's the question that I'm struggling with continuously. because it does seem to be, at this point in time, a not a personal situation with anybody. It's a global situation with everybody taking place, coming up. This is the intent of the younger crowd and those who go along with that crowd, who have this inquisitional attitude, actually. They don't see it that way, but it most certainly is. And again, there will be this sort of global judgment taking place. Flash mobbish, you know, just the spring revolutions, the Arab Spring and all that, you know, that just shows you what's going on. But what's really going on is this globalization of judgment, of simultaneously everyone being judgmental simultaneously towards someone. They're trying to create a total failure of someone's spirit, is what they're trying to do. It's way worse than Jesus' time. Jesus, they just crucified his body. And now they want to crucify your spirit. Okay, so imagine if everyone, let's say 3 billion people, or 2 billion, whatever, let's say 2 billion, all, well, maybe 3 or 4, television, wherever you are, you have a device where you're seeing something in real time, and you're seeing somebody that's been targeted as a bad, terrible person, okay, deserving to have their spirit annihilated. And so everyone around the world is focusing on that person, and they're focusing on the accuser, and they're focusing on the tweets, and they're focusing on the social media, and there's this massive rage has built up through 3 billion people. Half the population on the planet or so is all in this incredible hatred towards this person mode. All focusing their psychic, mental, emotional energy towards that person, saying, you don't deserve to exist at all. Your spirit needs to be annihilated. This is what we're headed towards. And you see, people are just crumbling. When this tribunal, this global tribunal pressure is being applied to people, they're just like, you know, just crumbling, because it's this collective energy of judgment and hatred and death is being projected on these people. And they're just crying. I feel so terrible for them, you know. Nobody deserves that. Jesus didn't suffer that. There was a few people jeering at him on the cross, but he, you know, the thieves were also got crucified with him. You know, a lot of people got crucified back then. A few people would notice, and that's it. There were some people jeering him, and as he went through the stations of the cross, you know, hey, a few people, hey, you know, yeah, some. That is nothing compared to 3 billion people all at the same time globally projecting total annihilation, hatred, and failure towards one spirit. You see, this is a crucifixion, you know, infinitely more severe that we've set up. We've set up an inquisition of crucifixion of that is off the charts, off the charts. And this is where we're at. Right now, this is where we're at. And of course, those who stand up for the poor, the person who's you know, experiencing this, you know, they're crushed. People say, you know, how dare you? You know, you're breaking our mojo. You're ruining our mojo. So, when I say consider sidestepping the situation, you know, I'm not just talking empty air here, just to fill time. I'm trying to fill you in on what's up, what's actually happening. And the rabble have all smartphones now. I mean, by rabble, I mean those who are very dedicated to failure and are super emotional about it. Very, you know, angry and emotional and intense. They're totally into that mentality. And they pour gasoline, you know, and other people, the gasoline pourers. The media is the gasoline pours, and the whole thing, you know, builds up That's what they're doing. I mean, hello, I've never heard anyone say this, but it's being said right now. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for this. This is what's happening on this planet. I don't have a smartphone, see? I refuse, that's why. I refuse. I don't have a tablet. When I go out, off the grid, you know. I got an old cell phone I never connect to the internet with. It's just for calls, that's it. And it does take texts. But I just use it for calls if I need to. Absolute necessity, and that's it. I don't check the news on the internet. Very rarely. But you occasionally hear things from people mentioning stuff. Occasionally, if I watch a baseball game, there's something, you know, I don't know. It seeps in. The paper comes in the morning. Sometimes I look at the headline or something. But I try to stay away from the news as much as possible. But the thing is, if you do not participate in these tribunals, people will finger you and say, obviously, you know, you're on the wrong side of history here, because you're supposed to be adding your righteous wrath to the situation, building the mojo towards what? Success. We're purging the planet of the evil. You know, we're causing actual failure of spirit, so we can succeed finally at being greater than God. So you wonder what Jesus is going to do, right? What's Jesus going to do? What's whoever is going to do? What's God going to do? What's the Holy Spirit going to do about this? Maybe if they're having these tribunals, that we could have those who have smartphones and TVs and tablets and all, you know, whatever, could be looking at something that is peaceful and loving, and they say, I really love this being. I don't have any hatred in me towards anyone. I have forgiveness towards everyone. Maybe we could get that mojo going too, right? Is that possible? Or do we sidestep the whole thing? You see what I'm saying? We need answers. We need them today. We need them tonight. We need them right now. I'm dedicated to finding these answers, or being part of the solution instead of part of the problem. And I hope everybody watching this video says, yeah, I want to be part of the solution to this. I'm aware of this very imminent problem, okay, of global judgment on people. And the energy being focused on people being unprecedented, causing even a saint to recant truth. The pressure may be so severe. In the scriptures it says the end times, that the evil in this world will be so severe that even the elect of God will be in danger of recanting truth. And you know, that's how severe it'll be. And so obviously they're talking about a pressure being brought to bear in this world that is unprecedented on this planet. A crucifixional pressure. And it's all these mobile devices, the social media, the televisions, all of this is that pressure. It is that pressure. And we're all targets of it. So before any of you, you know, shrug off and say, I can handle, you know, nobody can get to me, really. 3 billion people all insisting that you're the absolute, you know, root of all evil. And for the good of the whole planet, your spirit must be annihilated. You shrug that off, you know. I only know a few could shrug that off, actually. There are some. Jesus could shrug it off for sure. Buddha could shrug it off for sure. Sri Anandamayama could shrug it off. Ramana Maharshi could shrug it off. And there are some others too, right? You can fill in your favorites. So there are those who could shrug it off. It'd be nothing. Water off a duck's back for them, nothing. For us, it's a different story. It takes perfect enlightenment to be able to just not even bother in the slightest bit any of that. I know it doesn't bother Jesus. He's explained very clearly that how he sees everybody, and he sees all these roles that we're playing. He sees them all as beautiful, harmonious, lovely, wonderful, and you know, just like totally positive about everything. You know, so that's a great perspective. And we have to get to that, you know, sooner or later, hopefully sooner. So let's see what happens with this newfound clarity about just how severe the problem is. I didn't realize this before just doing this video. It just clicked. I realized, why am I so concerned? So scared, so concerned. It's not usual for me. Now I suddenly realize what's going on in this world. Just clicked. Over the last week, it's just clicked in, and now suddenly it just crystallized. I said, oh my gosh, that's what's going on. Global tribunals, global crucifixions. So, let's find out. Let's hang in there and let's find out, because this is going to be very exciting, what the options are that we have. Okay, thanks for watching. Appreciate it. Thank everyone for viewing these videos. I understand if you don't comment or like or anything because you're afraid of getting targeted from these global tribunals. But on the other hand, you might just say, you know what? I might as well just go all in with this, and let's say let's find out what our options are. Forget the fear of all this, you know. Let's face up to it. Let's push back. Let's not be so afraid we go into a shell here. See, I'm not going into a shell. I'm saying this live, publicly, worldwide here, and saying, okay, you know, okay, now we know what your game is. Now you get to find out what our game is. How about that? Okay. Very great. That's it.